This thin line represents change in the AMO, is basically temperature. You can see here is coming down, cooling and warming. Here you have a trophic level, it means the species, a different species represented by the trophic level. This is time. With the model, we have the biomass of each species by year. We standardize the whole information between 0 to 1. The red color represents the higher production or the higher relative production, and the clear yellow represents the lower production. The gray area represents the carrying capacity, is only the sum of the biomass along the each year. And you can see first that the carrying capacity is not constant, it changes over time. This assumption of a population model is not met in these cases. We have also noticed that there are some like a periodical changes. See, we have here high production, less production, again high higher production, lower production, etc. It is fluctuating with the world tendency this to decrease. These white dots represent the captures of the pink shrimp because we used initially this picture to explain why. The pink shrimp is coming down, and to recommend some things for management, because in the National Fishing Act, the objective for of management of the pink shrimp is to recover to the 90s, and then to recover to the 70s. It is impossible, basically, because it's, for example, this ecosystem configuration is come from this one, and this come from this one, etc. We need to recover at this time. We need a configuration like this, potentially here, to produce the next tip that's in this configuration. We don't know what happened later in reality. See? This is a similar picture for the Atasta. It's a coastal area in the southern Gulf of Mexico. We have more or less the same picture. This is the AMO. Here we have the decomposition of the three main harmonic components in temperature in the region. If I remember well, the red, the solid red line is the 67 period. The red, the dashed red is 27, I think, and the black one is the decadal variation, and the thin is the observed information. We can. Again, described more or less in the same way, this picture. The important thing is that if we have, okay, if the component of 76 years, in the harmonic of 76 years, is explaining 60% of the variance, and the sum of these three components can explain 70% of the variance approximately, so we can project these components to predict the behavior of the system. And remember that we have, for each year, we can compute the structure of the system. See? So this is interesting because if we can project, we can imagine in the picture which is the state of the stocks and then recommend management. This is the North Continental Shelf of Yucatan, is more or less the same picture. In this case, it's the red grouper. The red grouper now is about 30% of the size in the 70s. So again, the National Fishing Act recommended to recover in different steps to the previous stage. It's the same thing. We cannot guarantee to recover the stock, controlling fish mortality only. See? I mentioned it before that we can't project temperatures. I don't know if you remember from the literature that there's some mention that some strategies that that trying to mitigate negative effects to recover the state of the system before. What I try to mention here after the previous evidence is that we have no basis to think about this. This is, for example, the temperatures in the Campesino from January to August on this time. We have not any time in which the tendency is repeated. So the combination of this for the next years, we don't know what happened. we cannot predict really in this case. We can approach some if we have the really we are looking the Campeche Bank because the temperature we can project temperature for the next year with a 70% more or less of confidence, but not in other place. I find these things. Okay, what about the holistic ecosystem basis approach? we use it. Don't read this, please. We use it usually trophic models, and compute the energy that flows between prey and predators. It is really easy to compute it. If we can construct the trophic network, it's really easy to calculate the flows. I only put these things to show that the fluxes can be computed more or less easily. The important point is that we can take some indicators of the state of the network. So those proposed by Ulanovic, specifically ascending capacity of development, and the difference between these two is the overhead. This ascendancy is representing the state of the organization of the ecosystem, the organization of the network. The capacity is representing the maximum possible value of the ascendancy. So if you take, if you take this quotient, you can measure a relative order of the ecosystem, but the inverse is representing a measure of the entropy. And by definition, entropy is deterioration. With this information, we can construct these diagrams. Again, the species represented by the trophic level, the harvesting rate. The harvesting rate is representing the proportion of the biomass removed by fishing or other causes, potentially. The isolines, in this case, is representing just a measure of the entropy. This means basically that if we increase the harvesting rate, the entropy of the system also increases. The point here is that we want to identify an isoline that can represent the limit of the biome that we can remove without an effect in the organization of the ecosystem. See? We name it the isoline as isonoxus because the Latin is noxa is deterioration, and the noxicline to this name. The secret in this diagram is how we can identify this. There is a concept also coming from the ascendancy and capacity. The overhead is different in the ascendancy capacity of the overhead. This overhead is represent the energy intercept of the ecosystem. This energy is usually used to respond to impacts. It's an indicator of resilience. If we take from this overhead only the internal flux of the system, this internal flux represents redundancy. And redundancy is an indicator of a component of resilience. So we can compute the historical changes in this indicator and just take the mean value to identify which is the mean value of the entropy of the system historically. This value is representing this isoline. You see? So we can link this isoline with the resilience of the system, and we can decide which isoline we can take as a limit to define limits of fishing. Okay, in this case, for example, of the sardine, we can identify the trophic level to move to the isoline, to the noxiclina, and then to identify the harvesting rate that we must apply as much to maintain the order in the ecosystem. And we can do with different resources also. This is one of the indicators that we developed, because we think that this the concept comes from the organization of the ecosystem, so we are moving from the property of the ecosystem to some to define limits of fishing for the stocks. This is the same information. Really, this diagram is wrong because trophic level must be in the x-axis. And the harvesting rate is must be in this place. This is the same information than before. See, the same information that gives us in the, as in for each stock here is here. We can trophic levels, harvesting rate, and we can identify again for each species, which is the harvesting rate we can apply. These are examples of different ecosystems we apply this criteria. This comes from the Gulf of Mexico, including several coastal lagoons, the North Continental Shelf of Yucatan, one coral reef here in Florida, the estuary of Rio de la Plata, the Gulf of Salamanca. The heat diagram represent the connection between Lagoon of Terminal and the Campeche Sound together. And again, we can identify in each one of them the isoline that represent limits of fishing. It's more or less a consistent thing. But the Naxocline is representing organization, no biomass. It's not representing production. And for fishing, we need represent also production. See? So we tried then to develop the other three indicators, maximize catch per unit of biomass, the equivalent to the maximum sustainable yield in population models, and the concept of balanced fishing. This concept comes from the idea that the production must be equal to the loss of biomass to maintain the system. Each time that we run for each group an experiment applying the harvesting rate, we have this kind of skew. This is for sharks specifically. This quotient, catch over biomass, is represented the catch per unit of biomass that we can obtain from the stock. We select the maximum possible value as reference, and we can identify immediately the corresponding harvesting rate. We can get this for each group in the ecosystem and define a similar isoline than before. But this is represented the catch per unit of biomass this way. The same thing can be developed more or less for the maximum sustainable yield. If we take from this picture than before, if we take this descendant part of the curve, this emulate the biomass, the global biomass model in fisheries, because this represent how the biomass decreases because of the effect of fishing. In the case of the density dependence effects. So if we have this part of the curve, we can compute the harvesting rate corresponding to the maximum sustainable yield. Then we have this harvesting rate for each resource again, and this is the development, the points result in this case. Now, the balanced fishing, I want to explain from where we take this idea. In some years ago, Garcia and company and colleagues make some experiments running ecopat models, basically, and they try to equalize the production and extraction of biomass. They find that in a global sense, okay, they have three levels. The effects of conventional fishing in red, you see that the biomass decrease. The non-selected fishing and the balanced catch, dark blue. They said and they recommended, they run it, I think that 22 models, something like that. And in all the cases, this is a summary of the old cases, they recommended to apply as much, a harvesting rate of 40% on the whole ecosystem. Okay? We approach this balanced catch in a different way, using the primary production required to sustain catch and to sustain consumption. The idea comes from the, you can, for any stock, you can compute the equivalent in primary production that the species needs to be maintained, using transfer efficiency, something like that. So we have, in this case, the both quantities. This is the primary production to sustain catch and to sustain consumption. The idea here is that if the slopes are the same, so we could be under the concept of balanced catch. In this case, the slopes are significantly different. This means that that we need to move some of the rates up here to compensate and to get a similar primary production required. This is the same thing. You have one slope here and one slope here. We did this for 70 ecosystems. We have the slope related to the line of to the state primary production, to state catch, and to state consumption. Evidently, if the quantities are the same, you must go across the blue line in the bisectors. All the ecosystems that fall within this are on the balance and catch concept, and others are unbalanced. And you can manage things here or here to approach to the balance state. In our case, for the indicators, again, we apply harvest rate. We can compute for each group the primary production required to sustain catch. We can find this kind of cures. And if we know which is the primary production to sustain consumptions, we can identify the primary production to sustain catch that equals this amount. Then we can identify immediately the harvest rate corresponding to the balanced catch. And we can produce more or less the same picture, see? Trophic level, harvest rates. See? This is the first approach to the Central Gulf of California with the four different, I named this as an ecosystem reference level with the different criteria. This is the same case we have. I have not seen the balanced catch because honestly, the balanced catch I show here is a first approach. We are not finished it for the whole system. I put here because I want to show you. But for example, this is the Central Gulf, California, with the indicator of entropy, the maximum tunnel yield, and the maximizing the catch per biomass ratio. The basic idea is that if you have a clear objective for one stock, you can identify, for example, for one species, which harvest rate you need for each one of these criteria. So depending on your objective, you can assign the harvest rate. This is for the Northern Gulf of California. The previous one was the Central Gulf of California. You can, for any species, you can do the same thing. So the idea here is that we can provide holistic indicators that represent these four criteria, and the idea is that you can select for each species at the same time the harvest rate that you can apply depending on your objectives. Okay, which is the expectative of this implementation in Mexico? Let me say quickly that we have the opportunity to work by FAO 1 year ago. We incorporate in the recommendation these things. The CONAPESCA is the National Commission of Aquaculture and Fishing. Is the responsible agency to take decisions. The Institute of Fishing is the scientific advisor for this. The FAO consultancy was for CONAPESCA, and the recommendations come here. The Institute of Fishing is responsible for the publication of the National Fishing Act. The Institute of Fishing is asking us to collaborate to produce these things for the fisheries in Mexico to be incorporated as criteria for the to produce the national fishing chart. As a first step, the Institute of Fishing is expecting that for the Gulf of Mexico, we can have this criteria defined in 2 years, more or less. It's more or less the idea. So the point is that we have here the scientific side of the basic. We have here the administrative part, the institutional part, responsible for taking decisions. And the expectation is that we can produce this for the next years and include this in the National Fishing Act. The implementation per se in practice is more or less easy. This diagram represents the institutional arrangements in Mexico. This is the political, the national law, the constitution. There is a law of fishing. This law assigns the responsibility to INAPESCA and CONAPESCA. Then other research institutions work with CONAPESCA or can work directly by CONAPESCA, but all the information could be interpreted by INAPESCA to recommend to CONAPESCA actions. We have state-level organizations, but they only present to CONAPESCA their opinions, their requirements. The idea is that CONAPESCA have the possibility to call the fishing sector in any region. If we present this information to the sector, in this meeting they can agree for limits of fishing. And after this agreement, they can manage each stock represented by this square individually. See? So it's not complicated. Some people think that this kind of criteria must produce changes in the laws, but it's not really necessary. Well, this is represented only what happened, I explained it before, the consultant FAO for CONAPESCA, for the administrative issues, the scientific part is working on, and the idea is that we have, in this structure, we have administrative aspect solved, scientific aspect solved, and then we can put in practice. Well, it's all the thing. I hope you can understand me, because my English is not very good. I must acknowledge to several agencies that support this thing for many years, and to invite you to go to Mexico, to Los Cabos. Yes, I like it. Awesome.
Towards the end, you had a set of points, and you drew a line, and then for the trophic level, went across to a percent allowed sort of thing. That line, of course, has bar on it.
Yeah.
When you put it across by eye, I'm thinking it's a substantial fraction of the percent